We have our chief guest with us. Before inviting him, I would like to introduce him. Abid Rasool Khan Sahab, basically, he is an educationist and philanthropist, chairperson, State Minority Commission, very active and dynamic personality. ये जून 2013 से इस कमीशन के चेयरपर्सन हैं. इससे पहले जून 2013 से पहले एक तरह से ये कमीशन टोटली डिफंक था. जब से इन्होंने संभाला है, ख़ास तौर पर सोशली एंड एजुकेशनली बैकवर्ड माइनॉरिटीज़ के लिए ये बहुत ज़्यादा काम कर रहे हैं. एक्चुअली इनका एरिया ऑफ इंटरेस्ट एजुकेशन ही है. ख़ास तौर पर ये बहुत सारे एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशंस के चेयरपर्सन हैं, एग्जीक्यूटिव काउंसिल के मेंबर हैं, एज अ मेंबर भी बहुत सारी एनजीओस से ये रिलेटेड हैं, और ख़ास तौर पर जैसे मैंने कहा इकोनॉमिकली बैकवर्ड वुमेन एंड फिजिकली हैंडीकैप स्टूडेंट्स के लिए बहुत काम करते हैं. इनके जो काम हैं, इनकी जो एक्टिविटीज़ हैं, उनको यकीनन रोज़ाना हम यहाँ के न्यूज़पेपर्स में पढ़ते रहते हैं, मीडिया में देखते रहते हैं, तो इसको समेट कर पेपर पे लाना इंतहाई नामुमकिन है. मैं बस एक शेर में उसको समेटने की कोशिश करूँगी. जब कभी अबिद रसूल खान साहब की एक्टिविटीज़ को हम देखते हैं तो ये हमें लगता है जैसे इस अखबार के शेर को थोड़ी सी तब्दीली के साथ मैं यहाँ पेश करना चाहूँगी. यकीन महकम मेरे जहन से निकल जा रहा है शेर. यकीन महकम अमल पहम मोहब्बत फातह आलम, यकीन महकम अमल पहम मोहब्बत फातह आलम, जहाद जिंदगानी में हैं ये इंसान की शमशीरें. यहाँ मैं जेंडर की वो ख़त्म करने की कोशिश कर रही हूँ. यहाँ मर्दों की शमशीरें थी, यहाँ मैंने इंसान की शमशीरें. इस एक शेर के साथ मैं जनाब आबिद रसूल खान साहब से ख्वाहिश करती हूँ कि वो अपने तासुरात यहाँ पेश करें.
अस्सलामु अलैकुम रहमतुल्लाहि व बरकातहू. गुड मॉर्निंग रेस्पेक्टेड गेस्ट प्रोफेसर तिलक साहब, प्रोफेसर आमिना किशोर जी, प्रोफेसर शाहिद साहब, डॉक्टर आमिना तबस्सुम, एस्टीम्ड गेस्ट, पार्टिसिपेंट्स ऑफ द सेमिनार एंड द स्टाफ ऑफ मानू who is helping in the seminar to become a success. First of all, I would like to apologize for a delay of about 15-20 minutes, which was unintended and connected to my public life. I tried to make it before 10:30, but was held up somewhere. The second issue, I am privileged, I am honored to have been selected to address such an august gathering. People of the highest academic qualification are gathered here, and people who have researched and who have done a lot of thinking on this subject are there. So I am not really very competent to speak or advise such a gathering, but I would like to draw whatever I talk from my exposure in the public life. Professor Tilak has given a very exhaustive study of the situation in education, starting from the school level to the elementary, secondary and professional level. With statistics, he has explained the situation in the country and what we can do, where we are lacking behind. So my dwelling on that point would be of no consequence. What I would like to say here is that we have to have a look at the education from the beginning, as Professor Tilak has said, from the school level. And when we are talking about minorities, we have to see and emphasize and put ourselves in the foot shoes of the common person, a parent from the poorest of the poor section who has got a child of 4 years or 3 years and who thinks about educating that child. From there we need to start framing this policy. That is very important, and that is how the country can come forward and develop, and the vision of the people who matter today can be taken forward. I have seen that at the stage when a parent thinks about education for his child. He is very keen, and I don't think there is any parent in this country who would not like to have his child educated and see that he becomes successful. But depending on the socio-economic conditions, there are three options available at that stage. One option, if they are financially well off, they think about good schools, Montessoris, play schools, and then they go on that direction and they can afford to put the children there. I can tell you that in Hyderabad, a good Montessori or a good preschool charges about 50,000 to 60,000 per year for a child for an hour or 1.5 hour of study there. But still people have the funds, they have the money to put the child there, and it's their prerogative, we don't need to talk on that. Then the second is a middle class or the poorer section of the society who think of government schools. And then they think that my child will go into a government school. As soon as they have the minority label behind them, they are pushed towards Urdu medium. They are mentally pushed towards Urdu medium, because I have seen in areas where Muslim population is predominant, the government opens Urdu medium schools. The assumption and the argument is that more people would come for Urdu medium in that area, so we are opening Urdu medium schools. And as soon as you open an Urdu medium school, you feel that only Muslims should come there. It is not treated as a language. It is treated as a identity for a particular community. So there the students go into that Urdu medium schools and they get separated from the mainstream. Nobody is there to explain to the parents that these students are eligible for professional exams. Nobody is there to explain to the parent that these children can opt for writing their competitive exams in Urdu. They are totally unaware of this, and none of us have the time to go and talk to them and explain to them. As a matter of fact, I would like to draw on one particular practical example. In Mahbubnagar district, there was an exam for allotting ration shops conducted by the collector. I got a call from people who knew Urdu and who wanted to write in Urdu that there is no question paper in Urdu. A telephone call from the commission made the collector print the Urdu paper and give it to the people, and they could write the exam in Urdu to get a ration shop. So what I mean to say is, as soon as you talk about Urdu, you separate them from the mainstream and you put them into a separate category altogether, which is very unfortunate and unwanted. And secondly, then you come towards the poorest of the poor section, that is the laborers and all. They have no money to educate, or they do not have the means to send the child to the government schools. Here another issue which I would like to draw your attention is the localization and the positioning of the government schools. In Hyderabad, if you go into the old city, there are 5 schools or 6 schools in one building which are meant for different localities. A school meant for Azampura locality is located somewhere near Charminar. A school meant for Charminar or some other area is shifted to another place. When we ask the officials, they say there is no space available, so whatever space was available, we have placed the school there. So the whole concept of placing the school for the children is defeated. Because if my child, about 4 years, with no means of income, has to travel 10 to 15 kilometers to go to a school, there's absolutely no way that parent can take and bring her back. So here, we need to look at that also. Then thirdly, then we talk about madarsas. So madarsas is the reason for the poorest of the poor section to educate their children. The whole controversy about madarsa education and then communalization and all those things which I have debated time and again on the national channels and different this thing, I would like to say is, what is the choice? If you go into the statistics of madarsas, it is 2% of the population which go into madarsas. And out of the 2%, I feel about 70 to 80% go there because they cannot afford any other school. It is not that they are going there for learning the madarsa education or Islamic education, as you rightly say, but it is because they have no other option. Every poor family I have talked to say that they have put their child in madarsa because it is free and they get food as well as some money from there. It is not for the other reason altogether. It is not bad even if it is for the other reason I'm saying it is, but the choice is that if a child wants to study the mainstream education and also study his religious education, he has no choice available in this country that he can put his child into a proper school on par with other people. So this is from where we are going back. If you look at the amount being spent, a primary school teacher, government teacher in Andhra Pradesh draws 75 to 80,000 rupees salaries. With the increase in the wages, today a primary school government teacher draws around 70,000 and works for about 3 to 4 hours. It is much more than even a corporate schools. But the quality of education, if you look at the schools, is absolutely zero. The reason behind it is there is no controls. There is no participation of the community. There is no participation of people like you in these type of education. We are totally away from these education. We don't have time for that. So here, I welcome the judgment of High Court of Uttar Pradesh, which has said that all IAS officers, all babus should first put their children into government schools. Because this is absolutely a sort of talk we have. If you are sitting over coffee or if you are sitting into a good gathering like this, we say we should improve Urdu. We should put Urdu in the forefront. But when I question those people, any of your child is in an Urdu medium school, I didn't get an answer of yes from any of these top level people. None of them have their children in Urdu medium school. And they talk about the Urdu language. They talk about improving it. So this is, including me, I'm not pointing fingers, including me, my son has not gone into Urdu medium school or my child has not gone into Urdu medium school. So the point what I'm trying to stress is, why can't we have one mainstream education with the option to study the other religious studies or the languages as we had in our school days in public school? That was the what it was. But now today it is all over. Now communalization, as Professor Tilak has rightly said, ghettoization of education. Today, a Muslim education does not draw non-Muslim students. Likewise, a Hindu education institution run by a Hindu charitable trust does not have Muslim into the role. If you take any case study in Andhra Pradesh or Telangana of educational institutions, if you look at professional institutions especially, it is totally ghettoization. It is very unfortunate for the country. It is very unfortunate for us because that is where you are putting a solid foundation for communalism from the school and the higher school level. And then you talk of secularism after that. So you are separating yourself in the society. You are separating yourself in the residential colonies. You are separating yourself in the schools. You are separating yourself in the colleges. And then you talk of secularism and the unity of the country, which I think is just talking across the table just for the fun of it. But actually, nothing is happening on that front. We need institutions which can teach, not institutions which can breed this type of attitude in our country. That is very, very important, which you, all of you, I request you to have a thought and think about that, because it's a policy we are making, not just a improvement policy. It's a policy where the country would run on it. Likewise, let me start again from the school education. A child into a school education, we say that we are giving a lot of incentives. We say we are giving textbooks. We say we are giving scholarship. What scholarship are you giving? Scholarship for a child of, say, second class, that is pre-matric, up to 10, we are giving 500 rupees. For 500 rupees a year, he spends more than 500 rupees trying to get that scholarship. We have seen practically a parent suffering at the hands of the bank to open a zero balance account, spends invariably a couple of days going around. The couple of days, if you calculate in the wages lost, it is more than 600, 700 rupees already lost. Then spending money to open the account. Then applying for a certificate of income, which thankfully has been done away now by a self-declaration. But that was the situation. And then finally, with all the pairvis, he gets about 500 rupees, that too with all the difficulty. And then whether it comes to their hands or to other people, that is also a question which needs to be debated. So here, then secondly, when you talk about, again, reservations. Reservations is also a major issue here. Now, in Telangana, the strong debate which is going on is reservation of 4% or 12% under OBC for minorities. Government has committed 12%. Government has implemented 4%, which is also under the scanner of Supreme Court. The point here, what I mean to say is, why do you need reservations if you get an equal playing field? Because we do not get an equal playing field, we need reservations. When we need reservations, why do we have to plead and beg for it? It is reservations under the BC category. What is BC? BC is backward classes. Are people who are backward not a part of backwardness? Definitely, it's a basic law. And there is a will that needs to be done. If you want to give reservation, you need just a survey. But for a survey, you need years. And another survey which is done throughout the state is done in one day. And the other survey which is done for the children is not done in years together. So my point here is it's a will of the government of the state and central. If they want to give an equal playing field to the minorities, they can very well give it by some policy changes. If they don't want to give it, they don't give it for with any number of policies or any number of recommendations which we may give. So here I draw your kind attention, because all of you are the people who are going to talk about it not only here but in all the sections and all the foras. I want you to put this to the government, that the government is duty bound to give education to the children of this country, which is free from different classifications, which is free from different divisions, which does not make a poorer person, which does not make a rich separate person, and have AC buses and the other guy goes on a cycle. We need to, at least at the foundation stage, that is from the preschool up to the high school, we need to give an equal playing field. At least an equal playing field. We cannot give an equal playing field, but at least an equal playing field has to be given for them to grow up in their mind. For the children to feel that they are part of this nation, for the children to feel that we are also citizens of this country, and my father may be poor, but I am getting what I need to get. So this is a very, very important issue which I have always spoken about, and I also request you to take it up from here. Coming to the dropout rates, as the statistics have shown, the reasons for dropout in the minority especially, sir, is, as you have rightly shown, it is for the girls to help the parents, it is for the boys to help the fathers. This is a fact. If you look at any Muslim colony, which is in the old city or in the slums around the new city, even the statistics what you have talked about will be proved wrong by the number of students who are dropping out, because there is absolutely no support and absolutely no funding available with the parents to continue the education, and they are unaware about the scholarships. They are totally unaware about the rules and regulations, what is happening. And I feel that this is a very, very serious issue. And then secondly, where the students with all the struggle come up to the 10 plus 2 level, we have absolutely no career guidance in the Muslim community or minorities. There is nobody to guide them where they should go forward. So the privileged and the rich go for medical education, professional education, and the poor, now today we are again diverting them from the main education by saying that skill training is your field. Immediately we tell them that skill training, you get 20,000 or 12,000 salary and you go away from the main education into skill training. And today a totally different thing has happened. About 10 years back, or say 15 years back in this part of the country, Muslims were disappointed with education, and all the children were towards businesses, towards their father's businesses, or towards helping them, or going away to Dubai on some skilled jobs and all. After the scholarships, professional scholarships came, after the minority institutions came into being, after a sort of encouragement was given, we have today a total revolution among the minorities as far as professional education is concerned. The best example for you is to look at any wedding card of a Muslim family. It shows a post-graduation or a graduation degree, both against the girl, against the boy, which was not the case about 10 to 15 years back. So this is a clear indicator today, and this indicator can be watched by me by the number of students who are passing out of the professional institutions, and immediately about 80 to 85% of them are going abroad. And they are getting good jobs in foreign countries, both in the Western world and Middle East, as well as in the European countries. And today, the money that they are sending in has become a major chunk of the economy of this country as far as foreign exchange is concerned. As far as today the foreign exchange reserves are concerned, the minorities who are educated and who have gone abroad play a very, very important role in funding this. And that translates into the family lives and improvement in the socioeconomic conditions of the family. So at this stage, my appeal to all of you is, the skill education, though it is very important and very relevant, but it should not become a way of inducement for the minorities to go away from the mainstream education. It is what is happening today. Why skill education is being thrust towards the minorities? That is the question I would like to ask. I have attended a meeting of skill education in Delhi. I have attended a meeting of the parties on skill education, and I have seen the amount of budget and amount of thrust they are putting towards minority for skill education. Why is that? Why are they being diverted from the other educations which are available to them? Why not towards public service commissions? Why not towards civil services? Why not towards IITs? Why can't we have foundations for IIT? Why can't we have foundation for getting into civil services? The percentage of people, Muslim representation in civil services as good as 1% or I think 1.5% today. So the thrust area should be there. And out of that, filtration can be possible. Who cannot compete there can go to skill education and become some earning member of the family. But today, the government, unfortunately, is totally making a thrust towards skill education by giving the funds, by inducing, and without being wary of the means, without being aware of what is happening, our students are totally diverting from the education. The statistics are clear. A Muslim educational institution have not even recorded 50% admission this year in professional colleges. This is a fact. Then 30 Muslim institutions have been closed last year in Telangana. In 30 into average of 400 students, if you take, we are talking of 12,000 seats which have closed down. Where on the upper 4 years back, we had surplus admissions. So that shows that the whole scenario is being created in such a way by vested interest that the revolution in education should be again reversed. They should again come back to where it started about 10, 15 years back. This is a crux point which you need to think with your hearts, not with the statistics, and see what is happening in this and try to work out some modalities on that. Likewise, we have seen clear discrimination, in jobs, in any government jobs, in any other jobs, clear discrimination there. I will take an example of Usmania University where I was an executive council member. We had about 170 positions advertised about 5 years back which were to be filled up. All the positions were filled up except Urdu. And unfortunately then the vice chancellor was also Muslim. I do not want to name him. I was the EC member, I questioned it, I said, why not Urdu, we are not filling up. He said, no, none of them are qualified. I insisted in the EC meeting that the selection report be opened. We opened the selection reports. We found all of the candidates who had applied have qualified for it. Then when the second question, he said that I asked him share of Ghalib, he was not able to tell me. I said, that is no reason for rejecting a candidate who has applied and passed on all the thing, and you don't select him. We had a big ongoing fight and we continued that, but unfortunately with the support of the government nominees, he prevailed over it and said that we will hold a fresh notification. It is 5 years that jobs have not been filled up and those department is still without those professors. So what I mean to say is, in a classic example like this, like another example also I would like to take, in Karimnagar we have irrigation department project where 4% reservation, 11 engineers had qualified. For 2006 till today, that is 9 years, they have not filled up that. Only on the intervention of the commission, all the 11 posts were filled up only a week back. So here it was again a discrimination. So these discriminations in jobs, these discrimination in this thing, discourage the students from applying. There is a feeling, I have seen it, I am talking to the people, there is a feeling, they have made up their mind that we don't get the jobs, we don't get the position, so let us do something different. So here, when you are getting them all together encouraged from school education, secondary education, professional education, and finally when it comes to earning, you say you don't get it, then the whole thing reverses on the other family members. Other guys discourage themselves, but they don't feel the need to come and educate. So we need to give an equal playing field as far as jobs are concerned, as far as education opportunities are concerned, and as far as level playing field at the school level. When all the reports, including Rajendra Sachar Committee, Ranganath Mishra Committee, says that the Muslims are behind SCST and Muslims are totally economical there, then why not a special thrust area on the school education of the minorities, Muslims, and have proper schools for them or have admissions for them? Absolutely missing. It is not there in this whole society. We are totally away from the facts in the ground. You need to look at those facts also in your this thing, that how the Muslim child is growing up. If possible, couple of you need to also do a pilot study practically at any of these slums where this people are there and what type of school is existing. What is this thing? Urdu teachers, absolutely missing. If we have done in the survey of the Urdu schools by the Minority Commission, you will be surprised to know that in both Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, there is 72% vacancies in Urdu schools. Of other teachers, not Urdu teachers, even sciences, nobody is there. One teacher is taking four courses. We have done a survey of infrastructure for the minorities in both the states of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. All the 23 collectors have given me a report. The collector says we have no infrastructure to implement the minority welfare programs in our collectorate. And then you talk of budget. The fact is, last 4 years, if you look at the budget, the minorities budget in the state, more than 60% has gone back unspent. We talk, we give figures and we just return it silently without nobody knowing it. So this is the fact of the actual statistics and ground level realities. And if we are coming with a policy, my humble request to all of you is to recommend a policy which will give an equal playing field for the poor children so that they can study and come up in life and give them a proper career guidance where they can go up and decide what is to be done and then be a responsible citizen of this country instead of making them into a communally sensitive and communally, exposed person by saying that you have come from madarsa, so you are not a mainstream guy. You have come from there, you are not a mainstream. In what way, what wrong have they done if they have gone into madarsa? It was not by their choice. It was the society, it was the situation which made them go there and learn an education. So why discriminate against them? Why can't, when we talk of madarsas, I have spoken at the national forum, I have spoken at the national commission meeting. I said, what is wrong in that education? You want to improve it, you improve it. We did a survey in the state, we did a survey throughout the country also. And we got responses from over 90% of the madarsas who said, we are open for modern education. Let them come. As far as they don't interfere in our religious education, we are open for it. So what is wrong? When they are open, you come, give the best of education to the children, make them responsible citizens. Why again discriminate and say that this is a separate subject altogether? Why can't we talk about it as any other school? This is what it is. So the fact has to remain that today, the mindset has to change before the policy changes. Policy may be anything on the paper, but the mindset of the people who are controlling this policy has to change. For a change in the policy, we need the support from the media. We need support from people like you who matter, who can talk to people and tell them this is the fact at the time. We need people like all the participants to open up their hearts and talk very clearly and very frankly that this is the situation. Cannot be controlled by some power that we don't talk and we keep quiet. I personally believe that as long as I am in a position, I will talk openly, whether it will affect me or not, whether it will continue or not, that is immaterial, but I will say what is the facts. The facts are that today we are very vulnerable. Because we are vulnerable, we are getting disappointed. Because we are disappointed, we are not part of the mainframe. You have to encourage us, you have to give us the security, you have to encourage the children to say that you are responsible citizen of this country. You cannot on every instance say that you go away to some other country. That is not possible. We are born and brought up here, and if a particular section of the whole community, this thing country goes away to another country, the whole boundary lines of the countries will change. This situation has to be realized by the people who talk about it. My humble suggestion to all of you is, make the policy in such a way that the poorest of the poor section, who constitute about 90% of the Muslims, get an equal playing field as long as they come up to 12th at least, and after that we leave it to them for their better decision that what they need to do or what they can do, how they going to go about it. I am totally sure, I am convinced that all of you will definitely give some thoughts to my points, which are very practical and which are very relevant to our society. It is not something which is not known to you, it is already known to you, but I have been working totally into the field, so I am just talking my heart out, whatever I have seen there, and I am sure that this deliberation and the deliberations that are going to take after this will come out with some constructive policies or constructive ideas which will help the country develop and we become a responsible citizens of this country. Thank you, and I would like to thank Manu, Professor Shahid Saab, and all the officers here having selected me, having invited me to come here. I'm privileged and honored to have addressed all of you. Thank you.